Hello everyone. Thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qi Da. I'm an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Fluid Dynamics, and it is going to provide you a broad overview of the acceleration field and also the Bernoulli equation. I'm going to give you an overview of what I'm covering today's video. In this video, we investigate some typical fluid motions, fluid dynamics, in an elementary way. We will discuss in some detail the use of Newton's second law, as it is applied to fluid particle motion that is ideal in some sense. We will obtain the celebrated Bernoulli equation and apply it to various flows, then wrap up with conclusions. As a fluid particle moves from one location to another, it usually experiences an acceleration or deceleration. According to Newton's second law of motion, the net force acting on a fluid particle under consideration must equal its mass times its acceleration, F equal to m times a. In this video, we consider the motion of inviscid fluids. We assume that the fluid motion is governed by pressure and gravity forces only, and examine Newton's second law as it applies to a fluid particle in the form net pressure force on particle plus net gravity force on particle equal to particle mass times particle acceleration. The results of the interaction between the pressure, gravity, and acceleration provide numerous useful applications in fluid mechanics. To apply Newton's second law to a fluid or any other object, we must define an appropriate coordinate system in which to describe the motion. Next, we will discuss how to obtain the acceleration field if the velocity field is known. Consider a fluid particle moving along its path line as is shown in this figure. In general, the particle's velocity, denoted Va for particle A, is a function of its location and time. That is this equation, where xa, ya, and za define the location of the moving particle. By definition, the acceleration of a particle is the time rate of change of its velocity. Since the velocity may be a function of both position and time, its value may change because of the change in time, as well as the change in the particle's position. Thus, we use the chain rule of differentiation to obtain the acceleration of particle A, denoted AA. The equation shows here. Using the fact that the particle velocity components are given by UA, VA, and WA, this equation becomes this expression. Since the above is valid for any particle, we can drop the reference to particle A and obtain the acceleration field from the velocity field as this equation. This is a vector result whose scalar components can be written as these equations, where ax, ay, and az are the x, y, and z components of the acceleration. The above result is often written in shorthand notation as this equation, where the operator is termed the material derivative or substantial derivative. In many flow situations, it is convenient to use a coordinate system defined in terms of the streamlines of the flow. An example for steady, two-dimensional flows is illustrated in this figure. The flow plane is covered by an orthogonal curved net of coordinate lines. At any point, the S and N directions are perpendicular, but the lines of constant S or constant N are not necessarily straight. Without knowing the actual velocity field, hence the streamlines, it is not possible to construct this flow net. In many situations, appropriate simplifying assumptions can be made, so that this lack of information doesn't present an insurmountable difficulty. One of the major advantages of using the streamline coordinate system is that the velocity is always tangent to the x direction. That is this equation. This allows simplifications in describing the fluid particle acceleration and in solving the equations governing the flow. For steady, two-dimensional flow, we can determine the acceleration as this equation, where as and an are the streamline and normal components of acceleration, respectively, as indicated by the figure in the Morgan. We use the material derivative, because by definition, the acceleration is the time rate of change of the velocity of a given particle as it moves about. If the streamlines are curved, both the speed of the particle and its direction of flow may change from one point to another. In general, for steady flow, both the speed and the flow direction are a function of location, v and s. For a given particle, the value of s changes with time, but the value of n remains fixed because the particle flows along a streamline defined by n equal to constant. Thus, application of the chain rule gives this equation. This can be simplified by using the fact that for steady flow, nothing changes with time at a given point. Also, the velocity along the streamline is v equal to ds over dt, and the particle remains on its streamline n equal to constant, so that dn over dt equal to 0. Hence, we obtain this equation. From this figure, we can derive the second term of A equation. Hence, the acceleration for steady, two-dimensional flow can be written in terms of its streamwise and normal components in the form as this expression. The first term, As, represents the convective acceleration along the streamline, and the second term, An, represents centrifugal acceleration normal to the fluid motion. To determine the forces necessary to produce a given flow, or conversely, what flow results from a given set of forces, we consider the free body diagram of a small fluid particle as is shown in this figure. The particle of interest is removed from its surroundings, and the reactions of the surroundings on the particle are indicated by the appropriate forces present, F1, F2, and so forth. For the present case, the important forces are assumed to be gravity and pressure. Other forces, such as viscous forces and surface tension effects, are assumed negligible. The acceleration of gravity, g, is assumed to be constant and acts vertically, in the negative z direction, and an angle theta relative to the normal to the streamline. Next, we will introduce the Newton's second law along or normal to a streamline. Consider the small fluid particle of size delta s by delta n in the plane of the figure, and the delta y normal to the figure as shown in the free body diagram of this figure. Unit vectors along and normal to the streamline are denoted by s and n respectively. For steady flow, the component of Newton's second law along the streamline direction s can be written as this equation, where sigma delta fs represents the sum of the s components of all the forces acting on the particle, which has mass delta m equal to rho times delta v bar, and v times the differentiate s from v is the acceleration in the s direction. Here, delta v bar equal to delta s times delta n times delta y is the particle volume. The gravity force weight on the particle can be written as delta w equal to gamma times delta v bar, where gamma equal to rho times g is the specific weight of the fluid. Hence, the component of the weight force in the direction of the streamline is this equation. If the streamline is horizontal at the point of interest, the theta equal to 0, and there is no component of particle weight along the streamline to contribute to its acceleration in that direction. The pressure is not constant throughout a stationary fluid because of the fluid weight. In general, for steady flow, P equal to Psn, since the particle is small, we can use a one-term Taylor series expansion for the pressure field to obtain this equation. Thus, if delta Fps is the net pressure force on the particle in the streamline direction, it follows this expression. Note that the actual level of the pressure P is not important. What produces a net pressure force is the fact that the pressure is not constant throughout the fluid. Thus, the net force acting in the streamlined direction on the particle, shown in this figure, is given by this equation. By combining the two equations, we obtain the following equation of motion along the streamlined direction. We have divided out the common particle volume factor, delta V bar, that appears in both the force and the acceleration portions of the equation. This is a representation of the fact that it is the fluid density of the fluid particle that is important. This equation can be rearranged and integrated. From this figure, we know these ideas. These ideas combined with this equation give the following result valid along a straight line. For constant acceleration of gravity, it can be integrated to give this equation, where C is the constant of integration to be determined by the conditions at some point on the straight line. With the additional assumption that the density remains constant, this assumes the following simple representation for steady, inviscid, incompressible flow as the Bernoulli equation. Now we will consider application of Newton's second law in a direction normal to the straight line. We again consider the force balance on the fluid particle shown in this figure. This time, however, we consider components in the normal direction n and write Newton's second law in this direction as this equation, where sigma delta Fn represents the sum of n components of all the forces acting on the particle and delta m is particle mass. We assume the flow is steady with a normal acceleration An equal to V squared over R, where R is the local radius of curvature of the streamlines. This acceleration is produced by the change in direction of the particle's velocity as it moves along a curved path. We again assume that the only forces of importance are pressure and gravity. The component of the weight gravity force in the normal direction is this equation. If the streamline is vertical at the point of interest, theta equal to 90 degrees, and there is no component of the particle weight normal to the direction of flow to contribute to its acceleration in that direction. If the pressure at the center of the particle is P, then its values on the top and bottom of the particle are P plus delta Pn and P minus delta Pn. Thus, if delta Fpn is the net pressure force on the particle in the normal direction, we have this equation. Hence, the net force acting in the normal direction on the particle shown in this figure is given by this expression. By combining these equations and using the fact that along a line normal to the straight line, cosine theta equal to dz over dn, we obtain the following equation of motion along the normal direction. If we multiply this equation by dn and integrate across the straight line in the n direction, we obtain this equation. Thus, the final form of Newton's second law applied across the straight lines for steady, inviscid, incompressible flow is this equation. As with the Bernoulli equation, we must be careful that the assumptions involved in the derivation of this equation are not violated when it's used. From conclusions, what we learned. Newton's second law is applied to flows for which the only important forces are those due to pressure and gravity weight. Viscous effects are assumed negligible. The result is the often used Bernoulli equation, which provides a simple relationship among pressure, elevation, and velocity variations along a straight line. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today. And I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I'm happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.